All right. Welcome back, everybody. Sport Chat 503. Thank you guys very much for watching. First time, long time. Either way, I appreciate it. Coming to you live from Portland, Oregon. This one is talking about the Polynesian Bowl. And if you were a Duck fan, you got to watch this game. If you didn't get to see it live, If you didn't get to see it live, highly, highly recommend going and watching the highlights of this thing. Ducks were all over the field. They're on both sides of the field. I think it's one of those deals where, man, Oregon's showing up. And, you know, this is one of those games where historically, if you don't have players in this that you know about or are interested in or know are coming to your school, it's not like it's a must-see. Now, over there, it's a pretty big deal. And they show out. They have the red carpet. They got rings and everything. They hype it up over there. And it's good. It's good for them. But man, this is a game that there were some big plays. And, you know, again, as a recruiting, I'm not a guru. And so I don't go into this thinking that I'm the know-all on recruiting. My dad actually knows a lot more about this stuff than I do. I'll talk to my dad, and he'll be telling me all about these kids. And, you know, we got to get this kid. We got to get this kid. And I don't even know their names. So there were some kids. Obviously, Justin Flowe sticks out. You know, obviously, Noah Sewell sticks out. You knew some of those to going into it. But there are some really, really great players here in this Polynesian Bowl. So right off the jump, you got to talk about the fact that Justin Flowe, he is everywhere on the media side of this. I think he is going to be a face of the franchise for the next couple, 3 years. You know, Troy Dye, very unique player, very good player, and really set the tone for Oregon football on this rebuild. You know, he was a part of that group as a freshman that was willing to get in people's face. He was willing to kind of try to set the tone. He was willing to kind of try to step out on a limb as a freshman and take some ownership over a program that was kind of a dumpster fire in their minds at that point and kind of spiraling out of control. There wasn't good consistency. There wasn't really good vibes in the weight room or good energy in and again, you're coming off of a national championship where you lose the national championship. You got to rebuild it. It doesn't go well in the rebuild. You're trying to get some band-aids going on a little bit and it doesn't work. And here you have these kids, Troy Dye, Justin Herbert, who both really took ownership over this program. And Troy Dye, if you look at the history of him, you know, he got a lot more exuberant as the thing went on. He got a lot more comfortable behind the camera, and he was really, really outspoken as the end of his career. He wanted to get on the post-game interviews. He wanted to go dubs down in the post-game interview at Seattle. He wanted to be behind other guys when they were getting interviewed. In the Rose Bowl thing or Pac-12 championship, you know, when the cameras are on, he wanted to be there, knowing that this was really an opportunity for him to get some national exposure and get some opportunities to shine because he has a great personality. You know, I was there at the end of the game on his last senior night at Autzen there for the Civil War, and he was there for like an hour. He was like the last player off the field, signing autographs with everybody, taking pictures with everybody, taking numerous pictures with the same person to like get the picture right. I mean, like, the guy was there for all that stuff. And so you really got to appreciate a guy like him. I think Justin Flowe is going to be Troy Dye 2.0. I think this kid is going to be amazing. And it might be hype, but dude, I'm buying into the hype because when you watch his interviews, he is very, very, very skilled in the art of, he knows he's the guy that people are looking at. He's the guy with the good chiseled face. He's the guy that's presenting well for the camera. He was like a model. They put him on the thing. They put the uniform on him. He walked through the streets of Honolulu in the uniform. Like, what's up? He's got the uniform all tucked up. He's got the six-pack showing, you know, the dude. And then he is incredibly charismatic. When they put the camera on him, they put the microphone in front of his face, he knows he can answer the question. He worked with all the interviewers. I saw numerous interviews with him over this situation over in Hawaii for the week. And then the practice video. You got to go check this practice video out, man. Noah Sewell is flying around the field, man. The guy looks good. Offense, defense. There's automatic the guy's playing offense. You know he's going to play offense. He's going to be a short yardage back like, you know, Cyrus. Maybe he's going to be a guy who runs a wildcat formation. Mario's talked about that numerous occasions. You know, and so, but these guys just jump off the page. And the first, like, big play of the game is Justin Flowe hitting this guy on the sideline. And I'm telling you, like, even there was a play where they gave the ball to Noah Sewell. He runs out and Flowe's in on that tackle. He wasn't, like, the main guy that tackled him, but he was, like, the third in. And he's on that tackle. He's everywhere. So I really, really have high expectations for this kid. This kid, I think, is literally in the opportunity to start on day one. There's going to be guys in front of him. There's guys who are linebackers. There's guys who are coming off injury. There's guys who are already there. And I'm not saying that a freshman's coming in and starting over a senior, but that kid, I can guarantee you he's coming in looking to play on day one. And I would 100% expect him to be in the lineup on both of those games, that first game against North Dakota State and that second game against Ohio State. I think that is an automatic. I don't know if he's starting, but I know he's playing, because if that kid's healthy, he's a gunner. Now, I don't know exactly where Noah Sewell fits in, if he's going to be playing. I think he might have more of an opportunity sometimes to play on offense than on defense, but I know that they're going to put him in. I just don't know where exactly. I don't know exactly how they're going to run the lineups, and that's what's going to be amazing to watch at spring, because you get a good chance to see him play, I think, a wide variety of positions. I don't know if there's a more versatile player football-wise right now than Noah Sewell. I think he could do anything. I think he could punt. I think he could literally do anything. He could return kicks. The guy is incredibly versatile. He's thick. He's a 6'2", 260. He is thick, and he's got wheels. And this kid turns the edge, and defensively, he's hunting people down. So to have these linebackers show up the way they did against other top flight athletes is really telling. I mean, not only are they, in our minds as Duck fans, the top of the class, but when they go and play these other guys that are on the next level, they're in the top of that class too. Like, they stick out tremendously. Now, Noah Sewell did get a little bit of a knee injury. I heard it's like a knee bruise, maybe not too big of a deal, but he has an opportunity to be a phenomenal player. If he's anywhere near the brother's already looked at, Penny has already looked at as being the best offensive lineman in the country. And now you're going to talk about this kid coming in and being able to possibly play behind him as they're, like, running the ball. If he's a blocking back, and why would you not think that Mario might run some sort of I-back formation? This is a situation at Oregon. I feel like we're slowly stepping into almost, I know what, there's what Stanford did for a while, where when everybody else zigged, Oregon's going to zag. Or when everybody else zigs, Stanford was going to zag. Everybody was going spread offense, going light linemen, everything like this. Stanford beefed up their line. They added linemen. They went in a phone booth. They just ran the thing in a box. And I think that Oregon could be in the same situation. If you have an I-back formation where you have Noah Sewell in front as a fullback, and then you have Bene Sewell and you're running to the left, well, get out of here with that. So big, big, big ups for those two. Just those two alone are really, really big. Dante Manning looked really good. He was all over the field. Whenever you watch the high, I watched this thing like three different times. When you see the plays, there's a lot of times where guys are really, and these are games that are hard to watch in a way, because they're these all-star games. They don't really have that much time to gel. They're just running basic stuff. But I'm telling you, athletics, they show up on these kind of games. If you're a good athlete and you can cover ground on a field, it's going to show up. Chris Hudson looked pretty good, but I didn't get to see him play that many snaps as much as I saw Manning. Manning was all over the field. He looked very, very good. Justin Flo, we talked about, you know, a guy not Oregon related, but Washington State related, this Jaden DeLora. This kid looked good. He is the St. Louis quarterback. He's 6'1". He's good. Like, he can really put it on. Like, he had a really impressive game. And he's kind of smooth operator. Like, the way that he passes the ball is very smooth. And I was very impressed with him. So, you know, I know Washington State now with the Rolovich, with the new quarterback or new coach, you're going to be able to attract a quarterback from Hawaii. Maybe he already had a relationship coming from the Hawaii coach. But I was pretty impressed with him. Other guys, Feope. Whoa! Okay, he doesn't start, but he plays later on, big number 70 on the blue team. this dude is by far the largest dude on the field. They have him in here as 6'7", 390, but I've heard also 6'8", 390. Either way, 6'7", he is by far the biggest dude. 390, this dude is large. Now, I've heard what Mario has talked about. Oh, he's got to get him on a little bit of a weight regimen. They'll drop some pounds on him a little bit, but I would assume his playing weight's still over 360, and that is a humongous human being. 6'7", 360, and Mario says he really moves well. Now, blocking-wise, nobody got past this guy in the game. There were some times where the coverage broke down. Not like he's like the perfect lineman, but this kid moved his feet. And if you watch offensive lineman technique, his hands were on the inside. He was keeping good leverage. He was keeping good extension, keeping good connection. And these guys were trying to separate from him, and they really couldn't. And he wasn't holding. He wasn't mauling people. He's just so freaking big. And then you've got the defensive lineman, Marcel Efese. I don't know how you pronounce his last name exactly, but he was pretty good. He had a pretty good sack on Ugulele, the big kid going to Clemson. And he looked real good off the edge. Again, defensive player, defensive end, built more 6'5", 260, but built more like in the DeForest Buckner type body type. Not the thin, quicker guy that we have with Kayvon Thibodeau, but a guy that could really fit in nicely on the defensive line. And then offensively, you got to talk about the quarterback, right? So you have a couple situations here. You know, Oregon's gone into this realm since Chip left where it feels like they've gone just more pro style, like, you know, just having Justin Herbert kind of recalibrate that quarterback position. They didn't make him a runner until the very end of the year when he ran, and then he ran all over the place in the Rose Bowl, but they kind of didn't make him a runner. But they're not looking for that like dual threat quarterback. In the last 3 to 4 recruiting classes, I haven't really seen that many athletes who could play quarterback or dual threat guys. And then all of a sudden you have Robby Ashford. And Robby Ashford comes out and he looks legitimate. I mean, real good. He throws the ball like a baseball player, right? He doesn't throw the ball like the classic traditional quarterback. He throws it like a baseball player, but just like Russell Wilson, you know, just like we've seen from some of these guys, Kyler Murray types who play baseball, they can put it from a lot of different angles, almost Pat Mahomes, you know, and put it from a bunch of different angles, throw the ball from different spots, and really put it on you. Put it on you quick to the Z screen, right to the hands, and then he threw a deep ball that was just amazing over the top. And the guy's just got the swagger. Like, you can tell, you can just see it in his eyes. Like, incredibly confident, incredibly smooth player. He dodged a couple really good bullets. Like, guy came in, ducked it, got out of the pocket, ran over, completed the pass, took off, scrambled on another one. Played really well. He's number 12 on the white team. So again, if you just go through this and look at this thing, it's really, really fun to watch these kids play, because you got kids on both sides of the ball and you got kids on the blue team and the white team. Luke Hill, also number 21 on the white team. He played pretty well, you know, corner, but you know, I was really impressed with Manning. Manning is number 8 on the blue team, Dante Manning, and he got an extra star. I don't know how they do that. They just add the star because he's playing well or something. The season's over. I don't really know how that works, but so really just a great day for college football and seeing a lot of these guys come in. It was a great time to see. You know, they got to celebrate Penne there with a big award, and the quarterback for BYU, he got to play quite a bit as well. He was number 13, Soljay. He looked good too. He ran around a lot, scrambled a lot, shook one dude completely off of him, made the completion. So really great to see it. But my big takeaway is Justin Flowe, man. I think the kid is just next level with it. It feels like he's where Troy Dye was this year, with the personality, with the media acceptability, with the kind of swagger. You know, like, Troy Dye, I think, is a better player than Justin Flowe is right now. He's 4 years older and 4 years more experienced, but I think Flowe is coming in with way more confidence, way more charisma, and could be literally on day one or two here really a face of the franchise. Him with Kayvon Thibodeau, these guys are going to be really charismatic, man, and I think that is going to be a bigger recruiting possibility than anything else. I think these guys are going to recruit other guys way more than these coaches are going to be in these people's ears, because guys want to come play with guys like this. They have an infectious personality. And also, just like you can see, like, he led the team chant, like, he led the group to start with, and he was like, he was focused. Like, he was like, dude, don't let this thing down. Like, you know, he was running things, you know. And it's just interesting to see that. I don't think that we've really seen that end of a player come to Oregon at this level where Oregon is right now. I think the closest example is DeAnthony Thomas, and he was very shy. He was very quiet. He did not want the spotlight at all. And this kid's going to come in as a freshman, like, where are the cameras? Like, I'm over here. Like, call him a diva if you want to, but, like, he is going to be known. I can guarantee it. Okay, guys, thank you guys for watching Sport Chat 503. We'll talk soon. Adios.